interesting. This is Yud Zayin, or it's Yud Zayin Cheshvin, Rabbi Shimon Cowen at Hunter College Conference. Testing 1, 2, 3. He's probably running around. He's probably gonna get. It's gonna start late. I told you. I know him. I know Bourch. Welcome to the Noahide Conference. This is a conference on the Sheva Mitzvot B'nei Noach. We have the professor back there. My name is Rabbi Yakov Cohen. Rabbi Bourch Shalom Jacobson is going to moderate. We're going to have a panel discussion. Today is going to be on the topic is, well, I'm going to speak on the topic of Jewish law and mysticism, Noahide law actually, and mysticism. How Noahide laws relate to mysticism. And Rabbi Shimon Cowen is going to speak more on the social and the philosophical and the psychological levels of Noahide law. And Rabbi Bourch Shalom Jacobson is going to try to make sense of it all and hopefully moderate and give us an in-depth view of what we're talking about. Just to start off, the seven laws of Noah comprise of basically seven universal principles binding all mankind. They are prohibitions against idolatry, blasphemy, forbidden sexual relationships, including adultery and incest, murder, theft, cruelty to animals, and failure to implement orderly process of justice. Those are the seven laws. Now, these seven laws are basic laws. They're basic ethical laws. They're all ethically based. They are all moral laws. The question is, number one, there's two questions over here. Why should I keep these laws? Because God told me so, to do so. They make sense. Do I have to tell you not to jump off the roof of a building? It makes sense. That's question number one. Question number two, what's their interrelationship with Jewish mysticism? We know mysticism is obviously something which we're not familiar, we don't see it. Halacha law is something which is, we have a lawyer over here, Dr. Jack Schroeder, who's a professional lawyer. He knows law is concrete, right? You can define a law, you could clearly set out the law, right?
Yes.
However, mysticism is something abstract, right?
I hope so.
So the idea is to integrate Jewish law, Noahide law for that matter, with mysticism. Okay. Now, I'm gonna touch on two points. A Ben Noach, the children of Noach, must keep the laws because God said so. That's number one. And number two is, that you're actually doing, by keeping the laws, you're not just not killing someone, you're actually causing an effect, something much higher than that in the mystical world, which we're not privy to see. Obviously, some of us are more spiritually sensitive than others, but none of us, I don't think, in this room could say that they have the fifth dimension. They were people, great sages, and that have it, just to touch on that point, halacha and mysticism, law and mysticism go together. You taking notes? Okay, what's the idea of law? Mysticism, one of the great compilers of Jewish law was Joseph Cairo. He was a great mystic at Tzvat. And there's also the Moses Maimonides. He was a great mystic as well. He composed the guide, Perplexed, which is a great, as well as the Mishneh Torah. Then you have the other great mystic of our times was the Alter Rebbe, the first little Rabbi Rebbe, Rabbi Shneur Zalman of Ladi. He was a great mystic as well as a great halakhic authority. He composed the Shulchan Aruch amongst one of his great halakhic books, Shimon Cowen, Dr. Shimon Cowen over here has translated is Birchas Hanenet, which is a very intricate laws of how to make blessings, different combinations of food, and very, very in-depth. And maybe he'll talk about that when he gets up there as well. But he was a great, great halachic authority. One of the greatest halachic authorities of, you know, of our time. That's one. And the other great thing that he did was he was also a great mystic. He was the founder of Chabad. He created a new philosophy called Chabad, which is an acronym made up of three words, Chochma bin Evdas, meaning, and he authored the Tanya, amongst many other Hasidic books. The Tanya is a classical Hasidic book. I'm sure most of you, some of you have read it. And the question is, so one thing you see, that great mystics and great halachic go together. Why is that? Because in order to be a great halachic authority, you have to understand the true meaning of the law. And what is a law? What does halacha mean? Halacha means to go in motion. It means to grow, not just a set of rules. It's a way to grow, to grow as a person. When you have halacha, you're able to grow. So that's what halacha is all about. And by that, you're able to grow and create things. The Maimonides, which is the other great mystic and halachic authority you mentioned, has said that whoever does not commit whoever of the nations of the world listens to these rules, adheres to these laws, because God said so, he has a share in the world to come, just like any other one. And the Lubavitch Rebbe, Rabbi Nachman Mendel Schneerson, explains that the observance of these Noahide laws is actually will bring about the universal peace and the messianic redemption. Now the question is, we know two things. The laws make sense, we have to do them because God said so. Not only that when we do them because God said so, we also create a mystical, we're drawing down divine light, divine revelation into this world. That divine revelation is what's going to be revealed when Mashiach comes. That is what, right now the world is shrouded in a veneer of all sorts of temptations, if you want to call that, or concealments. However, Mashiach comes, that veneer will disappear. What will happen is, the world will see the divine light. And this divine light, everyone will see it, be conscious of it, and once you see it, you automatically lose your sense of evil. The evil will automatically, it's like light. When you light a match, darkness disappears. Darkness is not an entity. Darkness is merely the absence of light. When you have light, darkness disappears. So therefore, when we have this light, darkness will disappear. Anyways, just to touch on that point, the Rebbe explains also, bringing over here in the paper, regarding Mashiach. What does Mashiach mean? It means that the waters of the world will be infused. It says in Maimonides' quote, the quote from Maimonides, in that era, there will be neither famine nor war, neither envy nor competition, for the world will be filled with the knowledge of God as the waters cover the ocean bed. So just to touch on that point, what does it mean, the ocean bed? When you look at the ocean, there's a saying, everything that's on dry land there is in the ocean. However, when you look at the ocean, you don't see a horse, a seahorse, or fish. You see one entity. You see water, an ocean. That's because the ocean, the individual creatures lose their self-identity, so to speak. They lose their self-identity and they become suffused with this greater light, which is the water, which they survive. That's what's going to happen when the Messianic times. The world will lose its individual reality, and will become a unique one world to serve Hashem. And I think just to finish off that every person has to realize that this is to bring about this. Each, we can't say what's one person going to mean. What does it make a difference? One person, because every person is a microcosm. Every person is a like we say is a world in itself, and this world is each individual. They say, why was man created individually? Because to show that each person is an individual world. So we do make a difference. Everyone has the opportunity to keep these Noahide laws and to bring about Messianic redemption and to bring about universal peace and personal peace and personal redemption. And through this, we will ultimately see the divine light, which will bring about the Messianic redemption in our times. Any questions? Go ahead.
Yeah. The concepts of reward and punishment that are alluded to in the Shema for the Yidden, do they apply
to the Goyim
with regard to the seven Noahide laws?
100%. Because it's a law, by essence, you're a lawyer, right?
Mm.
By essence, a law means if you do this, you'll get rewarded.
Mm.
If you don't, you're going to end up in the jail.
Yeah.
You're end up, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there's consequences, right?
Mm.
Well, that's what Maimonides says, that it actually fulfills this divine. So, by definition, yes.
Yeah.
The law is the same for the Jews and the nation.
The only thing is, we only have seven. We only, non-Jews, like, what's your first name? Alicia only has seven to keep.
It's critical for the non-Jews to know that they have those laws to keep.
Sure, she has a copy now of the laws, right? And Alicia knows that these seven laws are to be kept, not just because you understand them, but because God told Moses on Mount Sinai, and He's a divine. It's a way to channel in divine light and to make the world a better place.
No, she's liable.
And she's liable. But you know, with Hasidus, we always stress.
Liability is not necessarily a bad thing.
No, it's not a bad thing. But we always, Hasidus always teaches us.
Yeah.
To out of love rather than fear, and always stress the positive and then the negative.
Yeah.
There's no, I mean, sure you could say you're gonna burn in hell and it starts. do we want everyone walking around thinking that way, Jack?
No, I want them to think about both things.
No, but what would you rather the world people?
If I had a choice between. Seeing only the good and being ignorant of the bad, or vice versa, I think people should be knowledgeable of the bad more than knowledgeable of the good.
I would tend to disagree, and I would like Rabbi Jacobson to come in on that point.
Yeah, because there's a huge risk there otherwise.
You should do not because you're scared of God.
I think
because love of God.
Naturally. That's
I love
that's
God.
That's a higher state of being.
That's what he asked me for.
But, yeah, that's...
But if you had a choice of one or the other...
No, you start out... The Rambam says, and everyone, you start out teaching a young child fear, but eventually that fear should dissipate.
What about when we wake up in the morning, Modi Ani?
Yeah, but if you
the
if,
beginning
if
of wisdom.
An 90-year-old man is still scared of God like he is when he's 9 years old.
I don't mean
that he hasn't grown.
I'm not talking about treachery.
Well, that's what you're saying.
No, I'm not.
In essence, you're saying that because you're saying that.
I'm not saying that.
What are you saying?
I'm saying that it's most, in my opinion, it's
right.
Most important to avoid the risk, and then go on. That's important. That's very important. Otherwise, if it's only good, and you can say, well, I can dispense with such good. I can maybe you have that good. Me, everything is fine. They're taking great risk.
You have a point in one sense that you have to have the basis. Once you have the basis,
exactly.
You could build on that.
Exactly.
Sure, no one's arguing that you have to have the basis that, you know.
Anyway, I just wanted to know if that.
The Rebbe brings an example from when we teach our children, in education in general, that there's two types of medicine. The Rebbe used the expression. There's sweet medicine and bitter medicine. Every child knows this. A child that you give him sweet medicine, what two things are going to happen? First of all, will he come back for more?
Yes.
Yes. It's all right. Second thing is, it will be effective. He will enjoy it, and he will heal with the help of that medicine. The same thing is in discipline. Sometimes we have to discipline with punishments, but usually, most of the time, if a teacher keeps the students busy, intellectually challenged, their curiosity, keeps their curiosity satisfied, he'll never have to punish them. I just went to PTA with my son, my 7-year-old son, that a teacher has in the room two charts. One is a bunch of goodies, all kinds of toys and tchotchkes that little boys like. And every time you behave or get a certain amount of points, you get to pick something from this store. It's a store, a whole store on the wall. My son came home with two of them yesterday. The other side is the punishment wall. He didn't finish making it yet because he doesn't need it yet.
Right.
Every kid has a red light, a green light, and an orange light. And if you're going the wrong way, you get a red light. And so it teaches the kid, don't go there.
Right.
But he didn't even get to that yet. So I said to my son, why not? He says, we didn't need it yet. Meanwhile, we're only focusing on the positive. So
right.
You do need to have discipline. Sometimes for the negative, which is what you were talking about.
I'm not saying I applaud the negative as an enjoyable experience in its own right. What I'm talking about is, look at Bereshis. I think if Adam and Chava had a notion of what they were going to lose, I think they were full of folly. And if they, in my opinion, and I know next to nothing. But in my opinion, if they had a clue, even a little clue, of what they were dealing with, they wouldn't have done what they did. So I think that Mode Ani is the beginning of it all. And without that, I think the risk is just too great. It's just too great.
But that's the nature of man.
Yeah, I know, but at least if you really know and your eyes are open, you have a shot at paradise. Anyway, that's all I have to say about that.
Okay, Alicia wants to ask a question. Dr. Cowen, please come up.
This is part of the panel. We need Dr. Cowen over here as well. He flew in all the way from Australia. We have to make sure that we use him out. Use him up. Okay, go ahead, Alicia.
Yeah, I agree with you. For one point, I think it's the fact of not ignoring that there's a bad path. But it's, I think the answer relies on ourselves as recognizing ourselves that we can choose either going for bad or for good. By knowing the laws and sticking to a positive side, you know that you have a choice.
Right.
But also you know that choice is gonna bring constructive consequences.
Because
whatever action you do is going to bring consequences.
Right.
But if you do bad actions, then it's going to be destructive consequences. But I mean, the point of not ignoring that there's a bad choice there, and you can, for some reason, you can, because it's the nature of man, I heard there, you can always go for that. But you have to understand that it's
going to
be destruction.
Hey, Elon. Grab a sandwich.
A lot of people think that those consequences are speculative, but they're not speculative.
No, I'm a biology major, and there's a consequence of that.
Right. Those consequences are very real.
Mm-hmm.
It's a kayak. Okay, very good. Let's introduce Rabbi Cohen. Why don't you introduce our guest?
Okay, I'd like to introduce Rabbi Dr. Shimon Cowen. He's written a number of papers on this, a monograph. He's coming now from a lecture tour. He's been to Princeton, Penn, Carolina, and where else?
Miami,
University of Miami. This is on the last leg of his grand tour of America.
and he's heading back to Australia. Hopefully we'll all go from here to Yerushalayim, but in the meantime, he's going to lecture us on the psychological...
Human personality and universal laws. Well, thank you very much. I want to thank my hosts, Rabbi Jacobson and Rabbi Cohen, for organizing this. Normally we see the last leg, you know, you see I'm on my last leg, and you see the guy that's about to fall over. Well, I've been fortified by a lot of very good sandwiches, drinks, I'm feeling actually much better than I did at the beginning. So thank you very much for your welcome. Now, I don't know, how much time do we have? We're going to get to about 3 o'clock?
Yeah, we have time.
About 3 o'clock? Yeah. Good. Now, the advertised topic of this discussion was human personality and universal values.
Universal values.
Values. What does that mean? So, what does this mean? What's the topic getting at? We're asking the following question. We are looking in society these days for basic values. We've had some catastrophes. We had a September 11. We had a Holocaust that was more than 50 years ago. We have a society in which generations are not necessarily coming together. They're going apart sometimes. And the question is, are there any basic boundaries? Are there any basic universal rules? What about personal morality? What about voluntary euthanasia? What about deception, advertising? What about various forms of trial lawyers, kinds of trial lawyers who advertise themselves as, in terms of their ability to win huge damage claims? Is this justice? Is this personal morality? Under what circumstances could a life be taken, whether it's a question of an abortion or a question of an assisted suicide, as it's sometimes called now, for people who are in terminal illness? What about the behavior of terrorists? What are the parameters? Is there anything which is right, and is there anything which is wrong? So this is a question which is very clearly addressed by the Noahide laws. The Noahide laws state that they state precisely this, that they state 7 laws with a number, with quite a lot of detail in them. And Paul, I might just mention the names of those laws. The first one is a prohibition on idolatry. It relates to some kind of belief in God. Then there's a prohibition of blasphemy, which means cursing God. And I suppose breaking an oath, which involves God's name. That's a form of blasphemy. Then we go on to forbidden sexual relations. Well, most people in this room, I'm sure, not sure will agree with everything, but most people out in the street will agree that incest is no good, adultery is no good, bestiality is no good, but I'm not sure how many people out in the street will agree that homosexuality is no good. But homosexuality is something which is also forbidden by the Noahide laws. As they say, in a flippant way, it's God created them Adam and Eve and not Adam and Steve. And there is significance in this. Yeah, I don't mean to have unseemly levity here, but there is a reason that a human being is the product of what a human being is the union of a man and a woman, and when a man and a woman get married, that is the highest form of their development. So this is something which is very crucial. And then we have laws prohibiting theft, and with detail. It's not just don't steal. There's detail in what it means not to steal. Are you allowed, for example, you're working in a factory. Are you allowed to go, are you working in a shop? Are you allowed to go and snack from the merchandise and so on and so forth, or you're working on a production line? What are the rules there? What about stealing somebody's understanding, deceptive advertising? There are laws. It's plain theft, we all know that's wrong. We all know that's wrong. There are many laws of theft. Then there are laws of laws prohibiting killing, murder. Well, as there we know, everybody, most people will agree to shoot somebody in the middle of the street's no good. But what about abortion? What about voluntary euthanasia? Then there's a law relating to setting up courts of justice, a notion of fairness in justice, consistency. I was just at a shiur before a meeting. We can acknowledge that there are different legal systems, and they might, and a whole variety of legal systems might be fair legal systems in the sense they're consistent. We just heard of a system where a grudge is a part, some tribal systems of law, where grudges are passed down and feuding is part, I have to verify, I don't know it myself, but if it's so, it doesn't sound very good. It means that a grudge and a feud is passed on to an unborn person who never did it. Well, that would seem to violate rules of fairness and justice. And then finally, we have a law which is a sound which will sound very strange to your ears, or maybe you've heard of it already. And it has a special significance. The law is the prohibition on eating the limb of a living animal. Now, that may sound wild to a person in the street. Who's going to go and tear a piece off an animal which is alive and eat it?